Thank you for having me come and speak to you today on the topic of the common good. I'm happy to address our Dominican community today, especially on this Founders Day. I'm happy to see so many Dominican Sisters of Peace in the audience, as well as faculty, staff, students, and friends of Ohio Dominican. You heard sort of a brief biography, so perhaps you're not surprised that I was kind of a little quizzical why you would ask me to come today and talk about the common good. I'm a medieval historian, first and foremost, and when we think of the common good, the Middle Ages isn't so much a time where we sort of consider that people are engaging in immensely selfless acts, that people are prioritizing the good of the community over the good of the individual. In fact, in the Middle Ages, it's easy to assume that people are locked into various social classes, that oppression is a common experience, and that only a small percentage of society kind of enjoy the privileges that are available in a rather bleak and dreary time. So at first I thought, okay, perhaps as a historian, maybe I shouldn't really be focusing on the area of my expertise. I've been lucky enough to teach in the humanities program here at Ohio Dominican and in the core curriculum. So I have taught to my students some of the great documents of Catholic social teaching, Rerum Novarum, the 19th century document that provides the kind of Catholic response to competing economic systems in the 19th century, unbridled capitalism, those industrialists who are after kind of profit to the detriment of the worker, who are not given any of the basic conditions and necessities to live. But on the flip side of that, we have a system of socialism that denies the dignity of the individual and the right of the person to self-determination. So I could, actually, that's all I can say about Rerum Novarum, so there it is. I've also taught in our sophomore seminar, I think the common text is Gaudium et Spes. And so this is in the time period of the 1960s, the great decade of social and political revolutions where we sort of are experiencing a world that is more interconnected than ever, and it's progressing so fast economically and technologically. And, you know, what is our response? What should our priorities be, especially when we see disparity between how we're living in America as opposed to those who are living on the other side of the world, which we can no longer ignore. And of course, Gaudium et Spes provides, you know, the Catholic definition, and of course I think I should read it, the Catholic definition of the common good. And the common good indicates, or the common good is, in fact, the sum total of social conditions which allow people, either as groups or individuals, to reach their fulfillment more fully and more easily. Well, I could discuss these documents, and I think I could do a reasonable job at talking about, for me, not whether it's the 1960s or the 19th century, this is history. And so I think that I could do an appropriate job and maybe get through today. But I felt that I wasn't really being kind of true to my area of interest. And unlike assumptions we might have about the distant past, you know, I find that the more I study them, the more I study the lives of men and women who lived 1,000 years ago, 3,000 years ago, rather than seeing people who lived differently, rather than seeing a society that is just so foreign, so mysterious, I'm finding that people's lives, the questions they've had, the challenges facing them, were no different than those that we face today. So I decided, rather than look at the recent past, rather than look at contemporary Catholic social thought and Catholic social teaching, I wanted to really bring us back today and look at some examples in the past that perhaps are challenging, perhaps maybe are not the first place that you would go to find examples of the common good, but in fact that I think we need to acknowledge. And the more difficult it may be to extract the lesson of the common good, I think the more it will resonate with us. In fact, if I were to if I were to even be more specific about my approach to research, I'm not a political historian. I don't really analyze the lives of the higher ups in society, the kings and queens and movers and shakers. I know a lot of people interested in the generals and the leaders and their kind of interactions. I'm not all that interested in that. I'm not an economic historian. I'm not a social historian. I'm married to a social historian. We actually are quite a team, you know. She can provide a lot of details about the daily lives of men, women, and children in the Middle Ages. In fact, my focus is intellectual history, and in fact, ecclesiastical history. I look at the monuments of the past. I look at the literary artifacts. I look at the ideas that men and women wrote down and that were deemed worthy to transmit to future generations. We often forget that what we have in front of us from the past has withstood the test of time. It was deemed worthwhile. All of our texts from Virgil, Cicero, all of the Greek philosophers that we have, we wouldn't have were it not for the transmission that occurred during the Middle Ages. These texts were deemed valuable. So in fact, when we go back in the past, when we reach back and look at examples that have survived today, we have to recognize right off the bat that these were deemed valuable. These were filled with the ideas that men and women sought to preserve and to transmit to future generations. So, where to begin? I'd like, as a historian, to begin from the beginning. I'm in fact not going to use a medieval example to begin with. I'm going to go back to one of the very first civilizations to emerge in human history, the Sumerians who inhabited Mesopotamia. I'm not looking at any of the political history of the time. I'm going to look at the very first piece of literature ever written by human beings, and that was the Epic of Gilgamesh. The Epic of Gilgamesh, it's an epic. And so an epic is somewhat historical. In fact, the Epic of Gilgamesh is based on a historical king, a king who we know nothing about other than that he lived roughly around 2700 BC. The epic was written down in 2100 BC when the Sumerians were interacting other cultures and wanted to preserve what they considered valuable about their own experience, their own ideas. So I figured, well, this would be a great place to start, and it's challenging right off the bat to see in the Epic of Gilgamesh a text that gives us any lesson, any idea of the common good. It begins with a king who is abusive to his people. It's a king who separates men from their families, who I believe he sort of summons them to war simply as an expression of his own authority, whether or not they have to fight. It's a king who, in a particularly despicable way, as recorded in the epic, invokes the right to sleep with the bride on her wedding night. Okay? So again, this may or may not have occurred historically, but in the epic, it was an act that represents probably the most oppressive, selfish, authoritative act any individual could commit. Okay? The people of Gilgamesh's city pray for help against their abusive king, and the gods answer them by sending them a champion. He was a wild man. His name was Enkidu. He was civilized, and he was made to fight with Gilgamesh, and in fighting, they became the best of friends. So it didn't quite work out the way they wanted. At least Gilgamesh was distracted, however, because in having Enkidu as his friend, they decided, let's go out and adventure. And so they went and they destroyed this monster of the forest, guarding precious cedar wood. And then afterwards, through one kind of insult committed, I believe Gilgamesh rejected the goddess of love. You just don't do something like that. They decided to punish Enkidu and Gilgamesh by sending a terrible demon for them to fight, which they were able to defeat as well. Well, the gods said, we cannot let these two continue unpunished. They have insulted the gods. One of them must suffer, and it was determined Enkidu was to die. he died, and it was at that point, that was a reality check for Gilgamesh, and Gilgamesh immediately came in tune with his own mortality. Now, when we have in our own lives such events, you might turn to prayer. You may sort of change how you're living in some way, being sort of brought in touch with our mortality in such an abrupt way. Gilgamesh it almost has an infantile reaction to this. He rejects his mortality. He is afraid. In fact, this begins his own personal quest for immortality. So he goes on this great journey, seeking to find the secret of immortal life. And it's believed to be held by a man by the name of Utnapishtim. The Discovery Channel had a documentary on him. They called him the Sumerian Noah. He is the one human being to have survived the Great Flood. And for that reason, the gods didn't know what to do with this man. He was supposed to have died. They removed him, and he got to live with the gods. So that's how the Sumerians dealt with that figure. Gilgamesh decided he was going to go and get the secret of immortality from Utnapishtim. He arrives there, and he is put to the test. Okay, you have to be worthy of it. And I think they said, you have to stay awake for 7 days. And he just fails miserably. I think he stands for 5 minutes. He's so wearied. It may sound a little, that's kind of an odd test. But think about it. This is reinforcing the fact that he's mortal. He's carnal. He needs to sleep. He's sort of unable to endure the test. He wakes up. He realizes he's failed. And as almost a consolation prize, the wife of Utnapishtim, she gets immortality too, decides to give Gilgamesh the secret, not of eternal life, but of youth. So there's an herb somewhere that if you consume it, it makes you young again. So at least it extends your life somewhat. Gilgamesh says, great, thanks. He goes home, he finds the herb. Rather than consume it immediately, he decides to take it back to his town, but he's duped by a snake. Again, there's lots of sort of Semitic kind of similarities in these sort of origin myths. He's duped by a snake out of this herb, and he returns home a failure. He's dejected. The end. Now, I don't know in that retelling whether you perceived anything at all about the common good. In fact, it seems to confirm our worst assumptions of past societies. We have a cruel, arbitrary ruler led by ambition, pride, fear of what he cannot change. We see the oppression of the weak. We see lives lived filled with selfish gratification. And in the end, we see a reluctant acceptance of mortality and the harshness of the human condition. Okay, now, I'm not going to send you off now to go home just so kind of depressed. In fact, I think there are some moments in this epic that I think are revealing and that do speak to the common good. For instance, when Enkidu is on his deathbed, this is Gilgamesh's friend, he's cursing his life, he's cursing his mortal body, he's cursing the fact that he was civilized and even brought into a friendship with Gilgamesh. And he's visited in a dream by a god, a sun god named Shamhash, and Shamhash reminds him that even though your life has been short, even though your life is filled with suffering, you have enjoyed the fruits of civilization and have known great happiness. In other words, while life brings pain, it also brings joy through friendship and shared experience. In another instance in this epic, Gilgamesh is trying to get into the realm of the gods, and he's barred from entering by the goddess of the vine, probably a very popular goddess. And her name is Siduri, and Siduri says, why have you come, Gilgamesh? Why have you come? Gilgamesh says, I'm so fearful of my mortality, I want the secret of everlasting life. And Siduri says this to him, Gilgamesh, why are you hurrying? You will never find the life for which you are looking. When the gods created man, they allotted to him death, but life they retained to their own keeping. As for you, Gilgamesh, fill your belly with good things. Day and night, night and day, dance and be merry. Feast and rejoice. Let your clothes be fresh. Bathe yourself in water. Cherish the little child that holds your hand and make your wife happy in your embrace, for this too is the lot of men. Now, I do teach this text to students, and I think here is a perfect definition of the happy life according to the Sumerians. But notice, the purpose of human life is not to live forever, but it's to enjoy what we can, the good that comes through our relationships. Now, lastly, when Gilgamesh fails his test, and he's given that consolation prize, and he decides not to take this herb that gives him everlasting youth, not everlasting youth, but another second kind of lease on life, back to the city, he doesn't take it back to the city for himself. He says, "By this marvelous plant, a man may win back all his former strength. I will take it to my city. There I will give it to the old men to eat. Its name shall be The Old Men Are Young Again. And at last I shall eat it myself and have back all of my lost youth." Okay? And in the end, when he loses it, he complains that this quest was all for nothing. And he's visited by a god who says, "You were given the kingship, such was your destiny, everlasting life was not. Because of this, do not be sad at heart, do not be grieved or oppressed. You have been given authority over people, victory in battle, but do not abuse this power. Deal justly with your servants in the palace, deal justly before the sun." So in the end of this epic, yes, it does leave us with a human who has to reluctantly accept his mortality, but Gilgamesh returns a completely changed individual. He was bringing this herb back, not just for himself, but to share. He had learned the lesson of responsible rulership, that he rules not simply for his arbitrary benefit, for his arbitrary needs, but rather to serve others. So I think it's very revealing, the very first epic we have, the text that was deemed worthy of being transmitted to future generations, leaves us with a very complex lesson, and one that does emphasize not just the quest of an individual seeking immortality and failing, but rather an individual who achieves transformation in his life, but from someone who thinks only inwardly to one who thinks outwardly. So that's my first example, and I hope to leave time at the end for questions. The second example I have, we're going to kind of move a little further in history. This is now we're at ancient Greece. Herodotus, the great father of history, gives us an account of history up until the Persian War. Okay, the Persian War, the great war between the Greeks and the Persians, which has been brought to the big screen in a very interesting way most recently. Well, before Herodotus gets to his narrative about all of these military engagements between Persians and the Greeks, he actually talks a little bit about the development of democracy in Athens. Now, I could just spend a whole lecture talking about that and showing how this, the development of this political institution is meant to, is a sort of tangible sign of the pursuit of the common good. Rather, I want to focus on a really intriguing scenario, a really intriguing episode in the histories, and it involves a reformer called Solon. Now, Solon, in ancient Greece, there's this huge economic crisis. Farmers had been forced to sell their property to aristocrats. They were out of work. It was just, there seemed to be no end in sight. Farmers had become slaves, in fact. Solon offered to find a solution. And he said, "If I find a solution, I want you all to guarantee that you're going to leave it in place for 10 years before you revoke it or before you criticize me." So they all agreed. Solon's solution was, and I'm simplifying it, to essentially release the farmers from their financial obligations. And then he left. Then he left, and he journeyed the world because he knew this was going to really be, it's like a Band-Aid, not a Band-Aid solution, but like ripping off a Band-Aid fast. A lot of people are going to be displeased about it. In the end, it did work, but he wasn't around to deal with kind of the growing pains of the solution. So Solon, a very wise man, journeyed to, you know, Egypt, journeyed to Asia Minor, and he came to the court of a king named Croesus. Now, Croesus was regarded as the richest man in the world. He was so proud of his riches and his treasures, and he realized that this wise man named Solon had come to his borders. So he said, guards, go, you know, get him, bring him here, wine him and dine him. I'd love to talk to him. And so Solon is very happy about this treatment, and Croesus summons him and gives him an audience and says, walk with me, Solon. And so he's walking him and showing him all the glories of his civilization. And he says, Solon, am I not the happiest man in the world? And of course, he's expecting Solon, having seen all this treasure, all this wealth, to agree with him. And Solon says, well, I could see that you're very rich, but I would have to say that the wisest or the happiest man who has ever lived was Tellus of Athens. Now, we don't have any information about Tellus of Athens except for what Herodotus tells us. And this is what Herodotus says. During the time of Tellus of Athens, his country was flourishing, and he himself had sons both beautiful and good, and he lived to see children born to each of them, and these children all grew up. And further, he is the happiest man, because after a life spent in what our people look upon as comfort, his end was surpassingly glorious. In a battle between the Athenians and their neighbors, he came to the assistance of his countrymen, routed the foe, and died upon the field most gallantly. The Athenians gave him a public funeral on the spot where he fell, and he paid him the highest honors. Now, Croesus gets angry, and he says, but Solon, you're missing the point. I'm so wealthy, am I not the happiest individual? And then Solon goes on a whole long speech. I can't give you all of it, but essentially, what Solon says is, I can't tell if you're happy right now, because you haven't died yet. That's it. That's the main point. No one can determine whether you've lived a happy life simply because it could be taken away from you. So I can call you fortunate, but I can't necessarily call you happy. Let's wait until the end, and only then can a determination be made. Now, the immediate takeaway of the story, I think, might confirm once again, you know, our worst assumptions of the past. Now, it doesn't say that happiness is wealth, at least, you know, there's that to take away. But it doesn't exactly say that wealth doesn't make one happy. It just says if you're wealthy, hold on to it. And then if you happen to die with money in your bank account, then someone can make that determination for you. Okay, so if you die surrounded by riches, then we can say that you're happy. But while you're living, misfortune can take it away anytime. So that seems to be the immediate takeaway. So once again, here's an episode in history where we have a text where clearly Herodotus is trying to make a statement. How are we to live a happy life? How are we to live a fulfilled life? And Herodotus says, avoid misfortune, you know, essentially. That's his answer. But I think there are further lessons in this episode as well. If we look at the description of Tellus of Athens, it says that his country was flourishing. Tellus of Athens was a leader in his day, and Herodotus believes that this is a very important detail. He had children, and he lived to see his children's children. Of course, I could spend a long time and talk about children as property and security, so because you have large families, it doesn't necessarily mean that this is a selfless choice of a parent to love children. I believe in this context, it absolutely probably means security and wealth. It does talk about his glorious end, which I think is probably where we get the most telling indication of how we are to live a happy life, because it shows that his death was given in self-sacrifice for his countrymen. So I think in the description of Tellus, we get somewhat of a comment on the common good. In Solon's long explanation to Croesus, which I couldn't really get into, we're left with more than just a lesson that if you avoid misfortune, you live a happy life. It seems to suggest the less you are rich, the more you value other things in your life. Solon makes this point. He says, the rich, they're lucky. they can enjoy lots of comforts, and they could sort of buffet themselves against crises a lot better than people who aren't rich. And I think we'd all agree to that. But he says, those who aren't rich tend to value other things in their life, such as friends, family, service. So when you are not distracted by wealth in this world, it tends to reprioritize you. Lastly, it's important to note that in this scenario, if the determination of whether we live a happy life is to be given by others, clearly those people who are going to say, yes, he lived a happy life, would likely have been positively influenced by that individual's life. Does everyone? So in other words, if it's other people who are going to make that determination, if you spend your life, a life lived selflessly or selfishly, it's very unlikely that an external observer is going to deem it happy. It's those who are affected most positively by the life lived who are going to make this pronouncement. So, we're going to leave ancient history, which is not my forte. I'm comfortable enough, but finally we have arrived at the world in which I'm most comfortable. Not quite the Middle Ages, we call it late antiquity. I want to talk a little bit about Anthony of Egypt. Now, Anthony of Egypt lived in the 4th century AD in a very interesting time. Prior to his life, Christians were lining up for their martyrdom during the Roman persecution of the Christians. In fact, the Romans sought to rid themselves of the Christian problem by throwing Christians into the gladiatorial games, putting them before animals, hoping that when the crowd, when the mob saw the suffering of the Christians, they would not see this as being an attractive cult, which they originally did, but rather simply just a group of a bunch of losers that had nothing going for them. And the Christians absolutely showed them wrong. Christians did not flee away from the Romans. They were proudly electing to stand in front of the crowd and receive this glorious death, because for Christians at the time, they were looking to find a way in which they could best emulate Christ. Now, Jesus gave us lots of lessons and lots of examples to live a good life, but really the ultimate way in which Christ or Jesus can be emulated is in death. And that's so Christians saw a martyrdom like a second baptism. Unfortunately, I know that sounds strange, unfortunately, the persecutions ended. Christians do very well when they're persecuted. But unfortunately, one Roman emperor named Constantine converted to Christianity. And with him, eventually, about 60 years later, so did the entire Roman Empire. Christianity became the official religion of the Roman Empire, and all of a sudden, Christians went from the persecuted to the, well, yeah, I'd be happy for a word. I mean, it was the status quo. They were on top of the world. And again, that did not suit most Christians. That did not suit. All of a sudden, lives became a lot more complicated. Lives became filled with temptation. Lives became filled with different paths available, paths of ambition, paths where wealth could be openly sought, paths where Christians could sort of attain great political influence and prominence. Anthony of Egypt was one such Christian living in the Roman Empire. He lived in Egypt. He was a son of a very affluent parents. And when his parents died, he was conducting himself like most Christians. He was a businessman. He went to church, but again, he was in some way kind of detached from his spiritual priorities. One day, as he was reflecting on Jesus's words, go out and sell all of your things and follow me, he walked into the church, and at that precise moment, those very words were being read at the pulpit, and he had a conversion experience. He went out, he sold all of his possessions, he did well by his sister who was still living and set herself up well, and he wandered into the desert and he began a life of self-sacrifice and prayer. He took on himself a very harsh lifestyle. He adopted ascetic practices. He stayed up all night praying. He ate very little. He mortified his flesh, all to subject his carnal passions and temptations so as to free his soul to ascend to a contemplation of divine. Essentially, what St. Anthony did was he founded Western monasticism. And the word monasticism means the solitary life. Now, it's interesting. I teach a course on medieval monasticism for our core curriculum, where the question is community and the common good. Now, how could I reconcile a course which is devoted to the solitary life and reconcile it with the question, the common good? The answer to this, because really, Anthony, one could charge Anthony of being selfish in a way. Anthony is concerned only with his own spiritual development. Anthony, in a very kind of Neoplatonic way, sees the material life, material existence as being a source of evil, something to subordinate, something to free yourself from, that it's only the spiritual aspect of humans that should be focused on and prioritized. And monasticism, the solitary life, is a means to subordinate the flesh, to free yourself of the distractions of the world, to renounce the world, and to ascend as much as we can in this life to the contemplation of the divine. So it would appear that monasticism, the solitary life, really is cannot very well be reconciled with the common good, except for the fact that Anthony failed. And this is no disrespect to Anthony. Anthony knew he failed in his life. The problem was that when Anthony receded to the desert, he was followed. Everyone heard of his great physical achievements. He would fast for 40 days. He would pray for days on end. And rather than being this emaciated shell, rather than being this meager little human with flesh wasting away, he would come out of seclusion radiating potency, virility, and everyone was just in awe of this, and so they followed him and they said, Anthony, teach us. And Anthony, of course, praying. Finally, he would go and he would, do a little teaching. It's like, okay, are you good? And sit. And then he would run away. And he would run even further into the desert. But the most keen and ambitious would follow him even further, hoping to emulate the great zeal and virtuosity that he had. And once again, Anthony would reluctantly teach and organize and form communities, and then he'd say, okay, are you good? And he would move even further into the desert. The only problem is, as soon as you get halfway into the desert, you find yourself leaving it. Anthony discovered you cannot live a solitary life here on earth. He reluctantly became the founder of another system of the religious life, which is called cenobitism. It's as Greek for the common life. Anthony organized these communities of individuals with a shared goal: to live as much as possible a prayerful life here on earth. And in fact, monasticism or cenobitism became even more a more effective way for achieving that goal. I oftentimes compare it to students going through university. At university, I tell students all the time, the grade is your own. The grade is your own. That diploma is going to be yours, and that transcript is all yours. You're on your own, at least once you have that diploma. But getting it doesn't mean you have to do it by yourself. You can take advantage of the resources of this university. You could study with other students. You could get help from professors. You could, you don't need to go through your university career alone to achieve that goal, which, yes, will be personal. Okay, and in a lot of ways, cenobitism, the common life, models that. Okay, so Anthony, when seeking his own spiritual development, finds himself working towards the spiritual development of all those who would follow him. All right, how am I doing on time? Good, I got two more. So, my fourth unlikely scenario, because I like the unlikely ones, occurs during the 12th century, and this is the great age of the Crusades, the Third Crusade precisely. Now, the First Crusade was a phenomenal success. It's a little kind of hard to take just how successful it was. Successful to the point that the Crusaders that went over to Jerusalem sacked the city, despoiled it of all of its treasures, murdered its inhabitants, okay? Now, I do want to say, you know, the Crusades are wars that oftentimes have been invoked very conveniently to say that more evil has been perpetrated in the name of religion than good, which I honestly hope no one buys into that hype. You know, those who looted, those who exploited, they were not on Crusades in any way for religious purposes. They were not doing, this was not Deus Vult, this was not God's will at all. The Crusades was a economic experiment, an experiment in colonialism. It served political needs, it served social needs in Europe. You can come to my medieval history classes, we'll spend all sorts of time talking about that. Just trust me. But the First Crusade, we can say in the end, Jerusalem was retaken by the Western Christians, and Latin kingdoms were founded. So we have kingdoms of Jerusalem. We have this sort of new experiment where the Western Europeans were living in the Holy Land. They established an uneasy truce with the Seljuk Turks, the Muslims in the area who had previously been the authorities. There was a truce. By the Third Crusade, however, some Christians were feeling as if to negotiate with Muslims was in some way to defy their Christian lives, that to negotiate, to consort with the infidel, heretics. Muslims deny that Jesus was the Son of God, and so therefore they are deemed heretics, considered heretics in the texts of the time. That to then negotiate with the heretic was to offend the Christian faith. So they said, we need to end this truce, and keep in mind, the truce was made to serve the economic interests of both Christians and Muslims. So I don't want anyone to think that the truce was made out of a great respect for the person or et cetera. It was to increase the flow of goods and so that both sides could get rich. Well, a lot of Christians said, nope, we shouldn't do that. We should dominate. We should take prisoners. And they rejected the truce and thus begins the Third Crusade. Now, The players in the Third Crusade are very famous. You know, we have Richard the Lionheart of England, who you might know. Sean Connery has played him once or twice. Richard the Lionheart, who comes off sounding really great, you know, really noble. He bankrupted England to fight a war that didn't need to be fought, essentially, and left his brother John, and I'm not trying to redeem John at all, but left him dealing with not only paying the money owed for this failed crusade, but also Richard goes and gets himself taken prisoner by a Austrian prince, and so they have to pay a huge ransom. And then all the Robin Hood legend stuff emerge. So we're not going to talk about Robin Hood. Richard the Lionheart, when he arrives in the Holy Land, finds himself fighting against another general, a Turkish general named Saladin. And they're just slogging in the desert. You know, one would have a victory, and then the other would regain that land. And they developed kind of a healthy respect for each other. Now, Richard had started gaining. In fact, he's marching on Jerusalem. He had pushed Saladin back almost to the walls of Jerusalem, and it looked like Jerusalem was in the Crusaders' sights. Except that Richard was extremely tired and sick, as was the rest of his army. And the morning before a great battle, en route to Jerusalem, he had sent out his network of sort of agents to find a suitable place to rest for the night. And he was told, here's a great location, there's a well there, and the well was absolutely essential, needed clean water, this is desert. And so Richard and his soldiers camped at this site. Unfortunately, the well had run dry many decades before. And so here was this army, out of water, out of food, out of medicine. And Richard, well, doesn't have too many options. His army can't fight. His army is sick. In fact, his army can't even begin the march home because they're so far away from the coast. So what is he to do? He does the most unlikely of things. He sends a messenger to his rival, Saladin, and asks Saladin for help. And what does Saladin do? He sends caravan after caravan filled with snow from the mountains, which could be used as water. He sends Richard, his personal physician, and he sends a whole slew of other doctors to tend to their enemy needs. So, what do we make of this episode? It's very easy. I mean, we could just look at strategy. It's very easy to see some strategic reasons for Saladin's actions. Now, I mean, he gets to look inside his enemy's camp. He gets to see the numbers. He gets to see, I mean, you could have surveys, you could have guesses. A tactical advantage. If you know exactly who you're up against, you know, that's going to serve you well on the battlefield. He'll see exactly how sick they are. He'll see what the supply train's like. That's going to serve him well. So there's a tactical advantage. There's a psychological advantage, okay? If one night I'm on death's door and I am being treated by a Muslim physician and he restores me to health, how am I going to go out on the battlefield the next day and fight valiantly against the so-called infidel? Psychologically, Saladin has completely defused the Christian army, okay? He's taken the vigor, he's taken the enmity away from them. So there are some human, there are some sort of reasonable, very kind of human, mundane reasons for Saladin's gesture. But there is also one that I think speaks to the common good. It also speaks to the pillars of Islam. The third pillar of Islam is charity. When asked for help by anyone, a Muslim is bound to be hospitable and offer charity. Saladin couldn't deny it. And it's interesting, this gesture of charity, which, and I'm not discounting the first two options, but we cannot discount the third either, this gesture of charity, in fact, led to a solution, led to a peace between the Christians and Muslims in the Holy Land that was to stay in place up until the arrival of the Ottoman Turks. In fact, through the arrival of the Ottoman Turks in the 15th century. The solution was that the Christians would get out of the Holy Land, that the Seljuk Turks could continue to be the authority in the region, but Jerusalem was to be made an international city where Jews, Christians, and Muslims can celebrate their respective faiths. And that was a status maintained all through the Middle Ages, and in fact, it's maintained now today. So, my last example, then we can get some punch. I'll maybe take questions depending on the time. I should check on the time, that's always a good thing. I think I'm doing all right. All right, my last example is not a challenge, is not a difficult text. In fact, I'm not going to set up a straw man that I'm gonna overcome. It's Founders Day. I think I cannot talk about the Middle Ages. I cannot talk about the lessons of the common good in a historical context without talking about the founders of the Order of Preachers, okay? The commitment to the common good is preserved in the Dominican motto, to contemplate the truth and to share fruits of contemplation with others. Now, I'm an intellectual historian. I love the history of philosophy. I tell my students about how academics have been viewed through history. I have kind of a personal interest in how academics have been viewed through history. There's a story of a Greek philosopher called Thales. Thales is pondering the universe and the cosmos, and he's staring up, and he's not looking where he's going, and he trips and falls down a well. And a slave girl has to come and pull him up, and she's laughing and mocking him. Okay? I mean, in that anecdote, you can see what most people thought of the philosophers of ancient Greece. Aloof, out of touch, impractical. Okay? Another, not so much a story, but a play by Aristophanes called The Clouds, has as one of its main characters, kind of removed from the action of the play, Socrates. Except Socrates is hoisted up on an apparatus throughout the whole play, and he's just floating above the action, spouting gibberish as he sits on a crowd. Just once again, showing where the academics and intellectuals kind of sit in society, how they're viewed, how they're disparaged, how they're considered out of touch, okay? The metaphor of the ivory tower is a pejorative one, okay? That professors who are so focused on the minutiae of their research area may not be sort of aware of sort of the pressing challenges that are facing the world today. It's comforting to be on this island of Ohio Dominican and not have to look at the news and see what's going on in the rest of the world. The Dominican order, interestingly enough, an order that produced the greatest teachers of the medieval universities, an order that produced great saints who are patrons of learning, doctors of the church, right from its inception, went against this notion of embracing this truth, this path of enlightenment that stops at enlightenment. In fact, for Dominicans, upon receiving the truth, you are not to rest. You're not to get comfortable at all. You're not to sit back and just sort of enjoy, and, you know, sip my romantic view of being a professor involves a fireplace, a leather chair. It might involve a pipe, okay? St. Dominic wants me to get up, okay, and not get comfortable. I'm just going to read a few passages of a work written by Jordan of Saxony. We don't have a contemporary account of Dominic's work and Dominic's life. A lot of our anecdotes come from a small, short little book, which, interestingly enough, doesn't focus just on Dominic. It starts with Dominic and then continues to talk about all the other founders of the Dominican order. So I'm going to read a few passages and maybe make a few comments and then give you my conclusions to this whole talk. All right. At the beginning of Jordan's book, it says, "During this time, a boy named Dominic was born in the diocese in the town, a town in Spain. Before his mother conceived him, she saw in a vision that she would bear in her womb a dog who, with a burning torch in his mouth and leaping from her womb, seemed to set the whole earth on fire. This was to signify that her child would be an eminent preacher who, by barking sacred knowledge, would rouse vigilant souls drowsy with sin, as well as scatter throughout the world the fire which the Lord Jesus Christ came to cast upon the earth." Again, I don't think anyone needs me to sort of lift language from this account. Scattering fire throughout the world, barking, you know, this is not an internalization of the intellectual process. While he was a student at Palencia, a famine arose and almost all of Spain was stricken. Being moved with pity for the poor at the sight of their misery, he resolved at once to put into practice our Lord's counsel and do all he could to relieve the wants of the dying poor. He sold all of his belongings, even his books, which he very much needed in the city. Establishing a center for almsgiving, he distributed his goods and gave them to the poor. This example so stirred the souls of his fellow students and masters in theology that, seeing how stingy their own help had been in comparison with this young man's liberality, they began to give him alms in greater abundance. Of course, I don't need to tell this crowd that the Dominican order is a mendicant order, and mendicant means beggar. That the Dominicans, from their inception, forewent property. They embraced poverty. They embraced poverty as a means to be better able to share blessings with others in the world. It was Dominic's custom to spend his night watches in prayer, and having shut the door, to pray to the Father in secret. At times during his prayer, he betrayed the feelings of his heart with groans and sounds which could not be stifled and be heard from a distance. His frequent and special prayer to God was for the gift of true charity, capable of laboring for and procuring the salvation of men. Since he deemed that he would be a true member of Christ only when he could devote himself entirely to winning souls, like the Lord Jesus, the Savior of men. Even in prayer. Now, when I first came to Ohio Dominican, I felt like a fraud and a charlatan because my academic focus was on Benedictine monks. And to be true and honest and responsible, Benedictines are not simply inward-looking, concerned with their own salvation. Benedictines pray for the world. Dominic, however, and which can be indicated even in looking at that statue right at the crosswalk, the Dominicans have a foot forward, are going into the world actively, praying for the salvation of humans, but also going out and effecting that change as well. When they reached Toulouse, they discovered that many of its people had for some time been heretics. Dominic's heart was moved to pity at the great number of souls being so wretchedly deluded. At the inn where they found shelter in Toulouse, Dominic spent the entire night fervently exhorting and zealously arguing with the heretical innkeeper, who, no longer able to resist the wisdom and spirit that spoke, returned by God's grace to the true faith. My favorite anecdote, and perhaps others, it involves, actually it doesn't say wine, but we have to assume it involved wine, and lots of it. Dominic took the whole night to persuade the innkeeper of the truth of the Orthodox faith. Now, what was missing from the inn is right here in front of me, a pulpit. There's no way you can have a conversation lasting all night where you are just pounding on a pulpit, spewing forth the truth, or barking it even. And I know it did say barking in that early example. Dominic must have subtly interpreted the word bark. There is only one way to have a prolonged and protracted conversation with someone who does not even accept the basic premise of the discussion, and that is to start from where they are and bring them over to where you are. In fact, that shows a great deal of charity, it shows a great deal of passion and patience, and it shows Dominic's concern with the salvation of those who have strayed in his life. After invoking the Holy Spirit, Dominic assembled the brethren and announced that, in spite of their small number, his heart's desire was to send them throughout the whole world, and that they would no longer live together in their present abode. Although they were very surprised at the announcement of this unexpected plan, yet, because of his evident authority of holiness, they easily agreed to it in the hope that it would result in a good purpose. I love the fact that Dominic's companions were completely sidelined by this pronouncement. Once again, I must imagine that they were a lot like me in some respect, that being sent out to learn at the great universities of Europe, to become intellects, become teachers, Dominic didn't let them stay still for a second, immediately sending them out. Immediately warning them from the complacency that would come with stability. Interestingly, Benedictines, stability is essential to the Benedictine charism, the Benedictine doctrine. Itinerancy is central to that of the Dominicans. So, some conclusions and then maybe discussion and snacks. I hope that just in the course of analyzing some of these difficult texts, that we recognize that the pursuit of the common good in human history has never been an accident. And by accident, I don't mean something that happened just by chance, but something that was sort of won, something that was innovated. The pursuit of the common good, I believe, and I think that we can see in the historical record, has been a priority of humans since the beginning of civilization, in fact, the beginning of social living, okay? It has always been part of the human condition that living for others has been seen as a way, if not the principal way, to achieve happiness. A second point I'd like to emphasize in conclusion was that there are many ways to serve the common good. We see in the examples that I discussed today, responsible rulership, something that we prayed for at Mass just before coming here. Gilgamesh, Richard the Lionheart, that leadership obviously brings responsibility, not simply an arbitrary pursuit of the fulfillment of life's pleasures. Another way to pursue the common good is to engage in charitable works and selfless acts. Tellus of Athens, dying for his countrymen. Anthony of Egypt, giving up his solitude in order to make more easy the path to salvation for others. Saladin, for helping his enemy and for eventually embracing him as an equal and bringing peace to a rife-ridden land. Lastly, teaching and preaching. Through the examples of Dominic and Dominic's followers, Catherine of Siena, Thomas Aquinas, teaching is a third way in which we could serve people in this world. Finally, in conclusion, I think that the mission of our university is perhaps one of the most noble and important when it comes to the service of the common good. Yes, it's important, I think, to bring students to an increased awareness of themselves and the world around them. Yes, Peter Symbolic is here, Mark Cooper. Yes, it is important to connect passion with purpose. No one paid me, but I figured it fit in perfectly. It's important to connect passion with purpose, to foster in our students a commitment to serve others as they go out into the world and live professional lives. Most importantly, it is important to help students and ourselves grow in our relationship with God. Thank you very much. Questions or snacks? Question, yeah. Right. I love the sort of etymological kind of origins. When I first was given the offer to teach here, my academic advisor sent me a two-word email: "Cave canes." You know, beware the dogs. Now, as a young faculty member, that might not have been a bad idea, especially one who thought he was a Benedictine and realized he was a Dominican in disguise. So the barking works, and I think, you know, especially in the times in which we live, it's important to be unapologetic sometimes and to be confident in the beliefs that we take out into the world. So. And that's why I've forever lamented the fact that our football team is called the Panthers when it had a perfect opportunity in naming him the Hounds. So, any other questions? Yes. Mm-hmm. This is why I hope when students do take history classes here, they see just how important it is just to appreciate and understand the complexity of the situation in the Middle East, the factions that exist in the Islamic world, that to just rush to a pronouncement and to a certain policy making without a comprehensive understanding of the history, not only of the Islamic people, but of the Christians and Jews in this region, is so absolutely important. Thank you. Any other comments? Great. Well, thank you very much. Thank you for having me, sister.